Shut up and sit down.
Hey, yo, man. This here's Blade. Sharp a razor blade. Because of his teeth. He's a good people. I am Ricky. Yeah, we saw you near Opal Street.
Fleeing from home where a wave of homophobia threatens his life, will Ishmael find a place to call home? Helping me unpack that is actor Warren Masemola, who is here on this episode of Beyond the Story. Hi, Puto.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, thank you, Jack.
I'm cool, man.
I even messed up my link because of the vibe that you gave me before we started.
It's a dancehall happiness. Jamaica, listen, one way.
Listen, yeah, I am into that music now. I'm going to pump it up as soon as I get home.
Yeah, man.
But how are you?
I'm good, you know, I'm in a better space right now. It's been a long 3 weeks of preparing for the show, Nine Lives.
Yeah, speaking of Nine Lives, you know, I was talking about how Ishmael was fleeing from home because of a wave of homophobia. Talk to me a little about some of the events that inspired the play.
So where we take it from the writer's perspective, Zodwa Nyoni, it's a story about a young man who leaves Zimbabwe, fleeing from how he would be treated in his own country, Zimbabwe, for the sex choice that he's made or that he's discovered about himself.
Yeah.
And I think it's still current up to today time, Zimbabwe, that homosexuality is not a thing. So they are openly homophobic.
Mm-hmm.
One of our celebrities from our shores tried to go there for a gig, and he was also faced with the same issues. So Ishmael leaves Zimbabwe to seek a better life in a community that would accept him for his sexuality.
Yeah.
He leaves Harare, Zimbabwe, for South Africa. He also gets to experience some injustice in South Africa that the writer doesn't tell us much about, but he ends up finding himself in England, in Leeds.
Yeah. You're reading the script. When do you get the moment where you're like, you know what, I need to be a part of this play?
They had me at the number of characters that are being portrayed by the one-man show.
Yeah.
So it's a really great challenge for me. That's my type of thing. I like to stretch myself. I like to challenge myself, do things that I've never done before. So I've never done a one-man show before. I'm also attracted in languages. So it was the different languages in the script that are portrayed by this one actor, apart from Ishmael, the character.
You are the life, you are the creator of the heaven and earth. So I beg, please heal him. Oh, you are the Alpha and the Omega. No one is above you. This is why I can believe that you can save him.
So that just had me at that. Nine characters, different languages, different personalities. It was a challenge that I was up for.
I mean, there's a snippet from the script that I personally resonated with, and maybe that you can shed some light a little bit on. Some of us were begging for a taste. Some of us to stop being afraid. Some of us wanted to find ourselves, and some of us wanted to belong. Can you talk to me a little bit about that?
So, you know, Ishmael has been afraid to come out in his own country, in Harare, Zimbabwe. So I think it would be speaking to that some of us wanted to stop being afraid, some of us wanted to belong, because Zimbabwe being home for him, he still felt like he didn't belong in Zimbabwe because Zimbabwe cannot accept him.
Yeah.
So, and he wanted to just stop being afraid in a country that doesn't allow him to be who he is.
Mm-hmm.
Some of us were chasing lovers, you know. It also speaks to, you know, a mutual feeling of love. You know, if you love people, people should love you back. But he hasn't been experiencing all of these. And you will find a deeper understanding of these, some of us's, when you watch the show, because they are set out differently, sort of like explaining, if not wrapping up, some of the chapters in the show.
Mm.
And it really hits home when they come after a certain particular part of the story that has been told.
So he goes on this adventure and this journey to find himself. does he eventually find some kind of a home? Because I feel like it doesn't matter wherever you go in the world, there's always going to be some kind of force that pulls away from you. People are not everyone is going to understand you, is what I'm trying to say. But does he actually find the solace that he has been searching for?
As per script, it doesn't tell us much, and it also doesn't suggest that he gets help or a place called home.
Yeah.
You will know that it's everyday life for refugees and immigrants, you know. You will never get to feel like you're home, especially if you've left home.
Yeah.
So it's a mode of survival.
Yeah.
So we see him at the end of the show, you know, he's still going to another place, but it's not back to Zimbabwe.
Yeah.
So I know that refugees and immigrants, you know, they could be in any part of the world.
Yeah.
It's nothing like home. It's just a place of survival.
Yeah.
You know, we see what's happening now in Poland, where it has nothing to do with color. It's not Kabul, but I forget this country that is just around Poland.
Poland, yeah.
You never really get back home, and you never really find a place called home.
Yeah.
It's just survival mode.
Right.
Yeah.
And it takes me back to like just leaving, even in South Africa. I think everyone thinks we are free, you know, and we can roam around as free birds. But even with the constitution that is as robust and protective as ours, we still find ourselves just trying to float and survive, you know. And I think you will know that when you have lived in some of the most gruesome parts of South Africa that still don't allow people to express themselves in a particular way, you know. So I think it's a universal story that you guys are telling, and some of us are going to resonate more. What are some of the lessons that you took away from the story as an actor?
The lesson that I took from this show as an actor is that generally the world is a messed up place. Our history, I don't think, especially as South Africans, we get to understand what history is and how it affects us in the world. We're not willing to even open our minds and hearts. So I think if there's one thing that the audience will take from this show, it's just an understanding of what refugees and immigrants go through versus the people who live in a particular country, and how does their rejection and acceptance, how does it affect us, rejecting them or accepting them?
Yeah.
I think it's a bigger lesson that we all collectively still need to acquire.
Right, yeah. And I think I love that because it speaks and it's testament to what actually theater is, which is a mirror back to us, what we are and what we don't want to be. And I think for us, if we can see productions like these and either change our minds or look at ourselves in a different light, I think for me, then theater would have done its justice,
absolutely,
you know, to the country. You spoke about the play having different accents. So you have to travel, right? Around Africa, around the world.
Yeah.
What were some of the most challenging things that you found doing this play?
I mean, as actors, we really thrive for perfection. And
especially you.
Yeah.
I mean, you're an award-winning. So that should count for something, right?
I think it just comes natural, you know.
Yeah.
You can't have bake it, you can't cheat it. Imagine I was portraying your experience in life and not coming forth with the truth holistically to represent you.
Yeah.
So it's the responsibility of the actor as a storyteller. What we do in theater is storytelling.
Mm.
So it was really challenging when it came to the English accents, because we've watched a whole lot of reference material, you know, but you never really know when you hit it, and that was challenging to have the confidence to say,
I'm going to do this.
I've got the language, I've got the dialect, I'm doing this. That was just one of the challenges.
I put Billy to his bed. He curls up and sticks his thumb into his mouth. Listen, yeah? He can stay for a bit if you want. Relax, son.
But what was also fun was to find the Zimbabwean accent. The places we went to with the person that was helping me with the coaching, language coach or dialect coach.
Yeah.
You know, he took me to a little Zimbabwe here in Johannesburg, and it's amazing. I mean, I've been to Zimbabwe before, but I was young then.
Yeah.
In the times that I went. And being at that place, I call it little Zimbabwe, like little Chinatown, little Africa, yeah. little Brazil. It really felt like being in Zim, you know, the palettes, the shops, the food,
yeah.
the music, the smell of the gas from the buses, because it is somewhat a depot for buses that leave yeah. Johannesburg for Beitbridge. And just sitting around there and hearing people's stories from Zimbabwe,
yeah.
it was very educational. And that's why I'd like to say that I think I enjoyed learning the Zimbabwean accent, because it was not just an accent, it was also learning their way of life. Mm. You know, I had to do some find outs about how to travel to Zimbabwe. And from the people that hustle a sale to have you on the bus or one of their buses that they work for,
yeah.
gives you a fully fledged idea of what's happening in Zimbabwe right now. Mm. I mean, for one, I don't know if it's openly available, this information, but Zimbabwe yeah. doesn't have papers to do passports.
Mm.
So do you understand what we're talking about when we say we need to do work permits for Zimbabweans?
Yeah.
Is it just going to be this side? Because it means that it can't be done that side, because
yeah.
even as a Zimbabwean with an expired passport in South Africa, going back home to renew a passport, there are no papers.
It's
going to
be a mission.
So it just tells you the amount of corruption, bribery, and etc. that is involved in getting in and out of Zimbabwe as a Zimbabwean living in South Africa.
Yeah.
And more so as Zimbabwean trying to find survival in South Africa.
Does it make
lawlessness,
you,
yeah.
Does it make you more empathetic having to be around that, having to absorb people's stories, having to see it at a very close proximity? Does it make you a more empathetic, not just actor, but Warren?
It does make me more sympathetic. The sad case is that I don't even know how to further help
yeah.
beyond the little way that I tried to help.
Yeah.
And hence I said earlier on, I think we just have to make ourselves understand. I think it's every individual's understanding that will help them change the narrative
yeah.
or assist where they can.
Mm.
Because we're dealing with the issue of anybody in the world who's seeking asylum
yeah,
truly
yeah, yeah.
really cannot go back home.
Yeah.
You see it with the people in Morocco trying to go into Spain. They go as far as being sewn into a mattress.
Yeah.
And we don't know how long the mattress is in a shipping container for before you just cross the sea, which is like about an hour less by boat, a speedboat.
Mm.
So some people go Morocco to Spain, speedboat, less than an hour. Some people take 7 days in a mattress just to do the distance.
Wow.
So there's nothing much I can do.
Yeah.
But at least I'm doing something about it in my little corner. But I think if everybody did their little contribution in every little corner that they're in, I think as a continent we'd be in a better place in years to come, because it's been deteriorating. And our border control policies are not the best.
They're not the best, and I think they need to be challenged. But speaking of contribution, Warren, you have contributed so much to not just the entertainment industry, to just the creative arts as a whole, and using that as a vehicle for stories like this that could literally change how we see policy, how we see the laws, you know, that have been put in place. But tell me about why it is that you decided to become an actor.
It was by chance that I found that this was my talent.
Oh yeah? So it was not deliberate?
No, it was not deliberate at all. My intentions was to go into the corporate world and do finance.
Really?
And like
what, a banker? Chartered accountant?
A chartered accountant, a banker, exactly. Just those two were my options.
Yeah.
Because I was really good at it. But when I matriculated, we didn't have funds in my family for me to go to school. So by sheer chance or luck,
yeah.
I had a cousin who was already studying drama in Pretoria at a university, or a technicon at the time. And she introduced me to the industry. I tried dance, it didn't happen. And I tried acting and it happened. And halfway through my career, I realized that this is my God-given talent. I do it with all my heart. I do it with all my might. I'm very passionate. It is my passion.
Yeah.
Yeah. If I'm not doing this, I'm just at home, just raising my child and loving my wife. But this is my happy place. Like, it feels like I do it with my eyes closed. So when people say, oh, your acting is so seamless, it's as if you do it with your eyes closed. I actually feel like that.
Mm.
Not to take advantage or grow a big head, but it really feels like surfing or swimming. I just become one with the volume of water.
Oh, wow. I love that. I've never heard it been said like that before, but I really love that. Take me back to, you know how when you start off with acting, right? It does not start off as seamless. Talk to me about some of the challenges that you experienced walking into it, especially walking into it by chance.
So, you know, I've always been like a loud person.
Yeah.
Jajarach, spapani. And I love it. You know, it gave me a lot of confidence in moments where I wasn't so confident.
Mm.
So after graduating, I got to do children's theater shows.
Oh.
And I was already, you know, told that there's industrial theater, corporate theater, the different mediums, mainstream theater, voiceovers, television, film. But I didn't have an agent then, so it was not easy.
Yeah.
And I had to hustle representation, management, an agent, because this is how you're most likely to get an invitation for an audition to showcase your talent.
Mm.
And I enjoy physical theater so much that it was my first gig. It was children's theater. We used to like take 10 books from a bookstore for children between the ages of 5 and 12.
Mm.
So we're just like grade RR to grade 7. And with a director and a producer with three actors, we jump on stage, put the 10 story books together with one book which got poems in it, and turn those poems into music and have it like a one show.
Oh.
So like you compress a book into 2 minutes, another book into 4 minutes, another book into three, and you storyline them together to tell one theatrical story for children. And children are very honest in their in their reactions.
Yeah.
And for it to be very that good, you had to be that honest to the children. And their honesty just made you feel confident that you were storytelling. You were doing storytelling at its best.
Right.
And I've always been scared of being broke in my life, even before the arts. I think that's why my choice was to go finance, corporate vibes.
So you work with Manny.
Yeah, because man, you know, I've been broke for a long time in my life. You know,
you never wanted to go there.
I don't want to go back there again. So I was really lucky, fortunate, blessed, favored that after that first gig here at Children's Theatre, then I got to do a musical at the Market Theatre, The Spirit of Jared Sokoto Gugamzimba.
Yeah.
And I then auditioned for Robin Olin. It didn't work out first time, but then because the auditions were so good at that point, she considered me for other shows. Then I got to tour a bit of Europe and other places and came back to the country and found a soap opera show. And then I just started, you know, just juggling one job to another, juggling jobs together at the same time. Sometimes I would juggle three jobs.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'd just be doing one job. Sometimes I'd just be not working.
Yeah.
But I'd say I think I was favored because they were not so far between
the gigs. Yeah.
I guess my fear and prayer just worked because, you know, it hasn't been bad.
Yeah.
And I've been growing, you know, respect as well, discipline, professionalism, focus. It helps you to be a better performer that people consider to work with. Maybe even when I'm not talented or the person for the role, but you know, it is how you equip yourself to become a better actor that bothers himself with more than the basic that got me employable, I suppose.
Speak to me about how much of that has also to do with alignment. And how I always believe that our steps are ordered. Do you believe that it worked out the same for you? That even when you had your own dreams and visions about where you thought your life was going to go, but that your steps were ordered in that direction, so there was no way that you were going to stumble and fall hard within the route that was chosen for you?
I'm glad it happened really at an early stage because at the dance college, I was very rude. I had too much attitude.
Really?
Yeah, I was arrogant. I was stupid. I can say now that I was stupid. So it was really a fall down to the ground because it was a year program and I was kicked out in less than 3 weeks.
Mm.
And I stayed in Johannesburg without telling my family back home that I was kicked out.
Yeah.
But in art class at the dance college, there was another lady who was from my hood in Pretoria, Soshanguve. So she got home before I got home and told and spilled the beans that when I came up with my act around Easter holidays, they're like, oh, really? No lies. We know you've been kicked out.
Yeah.
So I'm glad it happened at an early stage, because my rehabilitation and understanding where I was coming from and what I wanted for my life, I think I also realigned the purpose over my life.
Yeah.
You know, we pray for things, we ask our ancestors for things, but when our ancestors or the prayer calls back, you're not there to pick up the phone because your signal is not aligned.
Mm.
So I'm really, really grateful that I could align it at a really early stage. I was just, 19, 20? So it was early maturity.
And I think I love that, because most people are late bloomers and they don't catch it while it's still hot and while you can still bend it and while it's still malleable. What are you afraid of?
In life in general or in my career?
In your career specifically.
Okay. In my career, I worry or fear. Fear. So I fear, my worry and fear is the standards of the industry in South Africa, film, television, and theater. We need to be supported a whole lot more. We know what the government can do for us. We know what private sectors can do for us. We know what we do with what we do and how that heals society. I mean, we've just been 2 years under COVID restrictions, different levels of lockdown restrictions. And we are the storytellers that are telling those stories, because nobody's seeing them. It is this industry. It's the cameraman, it's the sound guy, it's the musician, it's the actor, it's the director, it's entertainment. A society without entertainment is a very dark society, because you don't have an escapism, and a lot of bad will happen. And I fear that the little respect we get as a collective might really discredit the value of the industry that we have. Especially when the outside world, by outside world I mean outside Africa, people believe in us, people invest in us, people trust us to do a quality work, you know. We now see Hollywood come to South Africa, we now see South African theater shows going into first world countries, and it really saddens one when you get the utmost respect, and not because it's the first world country, but because people understand what art does for society
and they appreciate
and a country.
So
that's my fear, man. You know, I don't know, the people who've been fighting for it before me, there are people like me who advocate for it right now. I don't know if the young ones after me being young will advocate and fight for it as much as we do as a collective. But more than being individuals and just fighting for the rate of your paycheck, we really have to protect our industry. My fear is we might not have an industry in the future, and we need to protect it. And that's why even in the type of stories we choose to tell as creatives, we speak to that this is what's happening to society, this is what's happening in society. We're here to do something about it. Just meet us halfway and protect our industry. It's of importance.
Do you feel, speaking of the protection of the industry, I hear you talking about future proofing. Do you feel that although you may have alluded to it, speak to more to me about it, about the future proofing. Do you feel that the people who are coming into the industry young, and I'm not going to say young because young in terms of age, but young because they've just started. Some people hit it at 40, some hit it at 20. But do you feel that the people who are now coming into the industry understand the fight, you know, that comes with sitting on the throne? Because everyone sees you as a celebrity, or everyone who's in the entertainment industry as one to be glorified, but do they really understand? Do you think they understand the fight that comes with the role?
I think they absolutely understand the reason to just fight for the standards of the industry. It's professionalism as an example. People might take it lightly to just arrive on time. But if that becomes a pattern, then it has devalued the professionalism or the or the standard and the value of the industry.
Yeah.
I think they do understand, but our industry is one of the harshest, you know, just to extrapolate. We are contract workers. Mm. We're not always employed.
And
I'm also speaking for people who are on soap operas. A soap is not on for 25 years, like Santa Barbara.
Yeah.
So I think they do understand. It's just how hungry you are and what you're willing to do to get, you know, instant satisfaction.
Right.
It's instant because, you know, it will take you from the beginning of the month to the end of the month.
Yeah.
And that's it. So, you know, we're rolling together.
Yeah.
But people are also rolling individually.
True.
So you can't really place it. But
yeah.
I know for sure. Yeah, I think everybody understands it. You know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Somebody will say, I would like you to do this. And for some reason, if you guys don't agree, they'll tell you to your face. And even if they don't tell you to your face, you already know that if you're not going to say yes,
yeah.
then there's always somebody who's going to take it. For whatever reason.
Yep.
It be money,
yep.
it be respect,
yeah.
it be, yeah, just taking care of the work, you know.
A lot of people see you as a role model. Do you believe that you have a role to model?
I don't believe I have a role to model, but every time, because people only know me through my work,
yeah.
I think they see me as a role model because of different roles that I've portrayed in my career,
yeah.
on stage and off stage.
Yeah.
It's also the choices of the roles that I take on.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's why they think I'm a role model. You know, I have people who hit me up on social media and say, you know, thanks for portraying the character of that father figure in that TV show like that.
Mm.
It really spoke to the family, or it really resonated with the country.
Yeah.
You know, one of my characters that I've done for the longest time, over 4 seasons, and I just finished shooting season 5 and 6 of Sestopla,
yeah,
is a gay role, like an openly camp gay role.
Flamboyantly gay.
So you have parents, and not just people who have been going through issues of coming out,
yeah.
but you have their parents who say, thank you very much, you made me understand and learn what this is, and now I am proud that my child is a homosexual and we can talk about it instead of being homophobic without being able to have a conversation.
I love that.
Which is another thing that, you know, we tackle here in Nine Lives, that Ishmael is not even like the other character, flamboyantly gay. You know, he's still coming out. He doesn't know how to come out. He really doesn't. So throughout his life, he's stuck in another skin, under another skin, and he can't wear his skin proudly. And you can imagine how damaging that is. Imagine if I was told I can't go to certain areas because I don't have hair. I'd be livid. I'd lose my balls.
I mean, and I think it's just testament to what you said in the beginning of this interview, that one of the lessons that you took out from the play was that we live in a very fucked up world, you know? Bleep.
Yeah, it is really messed up.
It's messed up, and I think you see certain things like that, and what I appreciate about it is that the fact that he's not flamboyantly gay is also testament to the fact that there is no template to gay, that there is no one, say, body or figure that, you know what, when we think gay or when we see gay, this is what it's supposed to look like. So you were sitting in your dressing room, it's after a show. What kind of music do you listen to?
Dancehall in the place. One way, fire we are make. I've been a lover of dancehall for many years of my life.
Yeah.
And my piano has taken over a lot of music genres globally.
Yeah.
So if you think like this is just for my 2000, you've got to mess up.
Never that.
You just got to feel the beat and the rhythm, and it will take you where you need to go. So before the show, it also serves as a warm up.
Yeah.
Just to dance to amapiano or dance hall, you know, gets me sweating, gets the blood warm, and by the time I go on stage, it is a boy.
Joga, it got me sweating before. Yeah, before we started this, if you were not the main character on Nine Lives, which other South African actor do you think would have portrayed the role, or would you have casted?
Yeah, if I say I don't know, I wouldn't be selfish, right? Because what I'm trying to say is I don't think there'd be anybody else to give this show as much heart as I do.
Yeah.
This is my life, you know. I interact with people who are not from this country.
Yeah.
I've been exposed to people of different worlds and different walks of lives outside this continent and in this continent.
Mm.
I've had the opportunity to travel vastly through my career. And some of the places I travel to is the characters that I play in this show. And
yeah.
It's also the languages they speak. It's also the dialects that they speak.
Mm.
So I don't think anybody would understand it the way I do.
Yeah.
And maybe they would have approached it differently. And before direction with Diamond, I think, you know, not every piece is for any other actor.
Yeah.
And this one has needs a lot of heart.
Yeah.
And I don't think there'd be anybody else to play it but me.
It's like music, right?
Yeah.
Once it's written for you, it's written for you, and only you can
yeah.
do it. Warren, what is the final thing that you want to say? Where is Nine Lives playing? How do we catch it? And I mean, what are people going to be thinking about as they drive back home from watching the play?
I think people will just take from what people will take from the show is the importance of identity.
Yeah.
The importance of belonging. The importance of seeing human beings for who they are.
Yeah.
They are human beings. I think that's what people will take from the show.
Yeah.
We overlook a lot about people, and we don't know where people come from. We don't know their backgrounds.
Mm.
I'm also just talking as possibly ourselves as South Africans.
Yeah.
You know? We need to look into ourselves. I think the word and the practice Ubuntu has long been lost. It's about time we go back to that as a people
mm.
and really understand what it is.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, when they say Namaste,
mm.
it means I see the God in you. The God in me sees the God that is
yeah.
in you. It's I and I.
Yeah.
It's Ubuntu.
Wow.
I think we'd love better.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
We'd appreciate each other better. We'd have heart.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's something that we bake on as Africans. We have heart,
mm.
but we seem to have lost it, if not
along the way, yeah.
losing it rapidly fast.
Yeah. And I think one thing that we have not lost is the fact that Nine Lives is coming to the Market Theatre. It has started from the 12th of November until the 12th of December. Be sure to catch it. He has already said and alluded to it. It is a story about identity, but it is where we're going to drink and find ourselves again. This has been Beyond the Story. I am your host, Thozama Busakwe. From me and Warren Masemola, Simkile. What's your favorite Mapiano song, Kakati?
Andiwele is my favorite Mapiano song. And also, just to say, people must buy tickets to the show. What tends to happen when I'm at the Market Theatre is that we sell out. So, also with the COVID restrictions and the number of seats available in the house, best book your tickets prior, because we've been selling out already in the past few days, and we haven't even gone through the first 5 days.
Yep.
So contact the Market Theatre box office online, if not telephonically. Do the best. If you miss on this one, I don't know. I did a three-hander, a two-hander. This is a one-hander. You might not be seeing me again on the theatre. I do well, so I do well.